at the Conservative Party, the New York State Conservative Party Political Action Conference, and this is the second day, and this is the luncheon, is our speaker, Judge Napolitano. He's going to be speaking at the lunch, and we'll record some of him. But right next to him is Mike Long, who's hiding right there. But we got him. That's the chairman of the New York State Conservative Party. Many of you may remember Judge Napolitano or know him because he's on Fox. Hannity and Combs, I think he's taken the place of Sean Hannity at times. In fact, during the Kosovo War, he was put there to replace Sean, and I was put there. He was the arbiter between me and Colonel Hackworth, now deceased. And there's Shirley sitting with Mrs. Long. That's Eileen. And I'm sitting here next to Ed Cox, the Republican leader. There's his name. There's Ed right up there with his back towards us. Okay. I'll just stand up and take a good look at this crowd. Really big crowd for the conference today. Beautiful.
I'm very pleased and honored to be able to introduce our next speaker. Joe DioGuardi was a congressman from 1985 to 1989. He's a human rights activist, an author. And his main focus is really fiscal accountability and financial management. And as the first CPA to serve in Congress, I think that he had a strong impact in Congress during his time that he served in that area. But I'd also like to talk about a time a number of years ago when Joe spoke at another Conservative Party function, and I sat in the audience, and I remember he said, first CPA ever to be elected to Congress, talking about fiscal accountability, financial management, and he pointed to his watch. And he said, look at my watch. And he said, every second that ticks away, the national debt increases, our deficit increases. And that hasn't changed, Joe.
Not at all.
And Joe had...
It's gotten worse.
Absolutely. And there's a quote that Joe has made that I think is timely. I'd like to just state that quote. Unless they are informed, unless they are motivated, the American people will not stop the upcoming financial tsunami that only increases in likelihood each day. And I think that's so timely. And I'm hoping that we've had an awakening, and hopefully we are getting motivated, Joe. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Nice to be here. I have my family with me, and it reminds me of my 1984 race when I came out of nowhere. And by the way, first practicing CPA. Believe it or not, there were five attorneys who passed the CPA exam. One of them was Herman Badillo. That doesn't come up. But he never practiced accounting. He practiced law. I was the first one to leave an accounting firm after 22 years to go into Congress. But before I do that, I have my brother with me, Dick, my sister, Angel, and my wife, Shirley. Now, why am I proud that my brother and sister are here? They ran my race in 1984. We made it a family affair and took back the most liberal Democratic district in New York, and certainly that part of Westchester at the time. Dick got in your seat. I ended up with the largest African-American population of any Republican in America, and I'm a conservative Republican, so it can be done. You gotta reach out and touch the people, and we did it as a family. And people might say, well, why aren't you there today? Well, guess what happened in 88? Mike Dukakis wins one state, and it wasn't his state, Massachusetts, it was New York. And it was a blowout, the party kind of abandoned, and I lost the way I won by just 1,000 votes. Mike, thank you very much for what you've done for the Conservative Party and Sean Marie. You have carried that conservative torch of liberty, the one you gave me in 1987, because I retired Bill Rabzo. That was my second race. Remember the one with the hat? That was my race. I had 12 races, let me tell you. Okay. By the way, are you proud to be American? Let's wake up this
morning. Yes.
Let's see.
Yes, sir.
Are you proud to be a conservative? Are you ready to take back America? Okay. If only conservatives and conservative Republicans are going to do that. Nobody else. I can assure you. And America is not well. You remember what Thomas Paine said to the tyrant, George III, these are the times that try men's souls. You can repeat that today. The tyrant is no longer King George, it's Washington. We've created a new plantation in Washington. It keeps growing bigger and bigger, and it's obstructing people from free enterprise, personal freedom, from jobs, and this has got to change. Well, now, Shirley, Angel, would you, I'm not going to talk about me. There's enough you can hear about me on my websites, Truth in Government. I did an updated bio, and that's being used now on all the social media networks. I'm going to let you have a copy now. Take it back with you so you know what I did as a congressman, what I did for 20 years after Congress. I didn't become a paid lobbyist. I went back to work on the boards of companies. I made a living. Thank God I made some money. And yes, I'm ready to run again. And you'll hear about that in 2 weeks, okay? So, did everyone get a copy of this book? If you didn't, by the time you leave, my family will be in the back to hand this to you. Take it. This book was written 17 years ago, but it's like it was written today. But for you, because I think you are special people, and this party is special, because without the Conservative Party, I would never have been elected in that district. In fact, there weren't enough Republican votes. I won that race with a plurality. I think 14,000 conservative votes gave me the 2,000 majority I needed to win that district. So I know how important you are. But what I did for you in the last 2 weeks is I prepared an update of this book. I'm going to update the book, but I wanted you to have it now. This is a new forward. This tells you what we did between 17 years ago and today. It not only tells you the bad news, because I'm someone who likes solutions. When you're a CPA, you always look to solve the problem. And I'm giving you my plan to get out of this national debt in here. But also what I included for you is a chronology. 5 pages. How did we get from 17 years ago to here? How did things get so out of control? You heard the story about the frog that was put in a little tank and they raised the temperature imperceptibly every day, let's say a quarter of a degree. You know what happened to that frog? It boiled to death because it didn't know enough to jump out. That's what's happening to us. Every year, we just increase the spending, increase the debt, we keep things off the books, we seduce you into thinking it's not that bad when it's terrible, and guess what the end result is? America will not be sustainable in 10 years. There's no doubt in my mind. It's not what you're hearing. The debt is not $12 trillion. By the way, when I wrote the book, the national debt on the books was $3 trillion. 17 years, it's now $12 trillion. And what does Obama say? He thinks we're going to spend another deficit this year. Last year it was $1.4 trillion. This year they're expecting $1.3 trillion. But he has said that in the next 10 years, he expects to add $10 trillion to the national debt on the books. You talk about big government. That's $22 trillion. Now, let's just look at this common sense. You don't have to be a CPA to understand what's happening here. Even if you kept interest rates, Mike, down to 5%. Now, I know they're lower than that now. Why? Because we are cooking the books. Again, we're fully America. We've got the Federal Reserve, which has no audit, just making the money supply as big as possible. We still don't know what the bailouts have cost us between what the Treasury has spent and what the Federal Reserve has spent. This is very dangerous, because if we allow this to happen, you know what happened in 1979. What enabled Ronald Reagan to win? And I'm going to give you a bit of his speech in 1980, before he became president. Interest, the prime rate was 21%. Inflation was in the high teens. That's going to happen again. If not 21, you can be sure it's going to go back to 5, 6, 7, or 8, the prime rate. Multiply the lower number I just gave you, 5%, by 20 trillion. That's $1 trillion interest. The worst tax in the world is interest. And a lot of it's going to go to countries we don't trust, like China. Because we're borrowing from China right now. On the books with China now, $1 trillion in treasury bills we have. Plus, we don't even know how much they've lent Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac because there are other things that are off the books. Remember Enron? Special purpose entities? We got them. They're called government-sponsored enterprises, GSEs. There's 28 of them. Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation, the Post Office. I can give you the whole list. Read my book, you'll get them. That's not on the budget. When they talk about the deficit, they're not telling that. And by the way, do you remember what Lyndon Baines Johnson did, which is what got me to run for Congress in 84? The biggest shell game in the world with the books to disguise the cost
of the war on Vietnam, he came up with this thing called the unified budget. Why? He saw the surpluses in the Social Security trust account. We didn't have Medicare back then, it was just starting. Now we have two trust accounts that are big. And he said, why should I report these big deficits when I could meld those surpluses in the budget process and just offset the deficit and make it look lower? We have never changed that. So when you get the deficit, what you're getting is a deficit that has been reduced artificially because the surpluses in the Social Security account are offset against it. Now we have Medicare as well. This is not telling the truth. That's why I started a foundation 20 years ago after I left Congress and wrote this book. The name of my foundation is Truth in Government. When you get this book, you'll get my card. Go on that website and see what's really going on in America. We must stop this. And the reason we must stop it is not because it's philosophical, because we will not be sustainable. This country will never be able to create jobs, compete globally, and even defend ourselves if we're going to spend $1 trillion and more in interest. And you know, Obama doesn't want to talk about that because that's too far off. It's not that far off. So we got big problems that we have to deal with. And let me give you some inspiration for Ronald Reagan. Because before I came here, someone told me if I went onto YouTube in a certain spot, I would get his convention speech in 1980. And I listened to that speech late Saturday night. He could give that speech here today. He said, the Carter administration is a bad cocktail. We have high interest, high inflation, high taxes, low growth, high unemployment, big government. One of the only things that differ today, because we've cooked the books artificially, the high interest and the high inflation. But that's coming. You cannot spend the kind of money we just spent and not have inflation coming down the pipe. And that is the worst tax on people with pensions, people with cash, and that's going to make people with real estate even richer. So we're going to create a country where the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. And what's happening to America? You got to start thinking about this. Now you're in New York State. Think about something else. There are several states in this union which are highly dependent on the federal government for grants, for Medicaid. We are one of them. Almost 20% of the budget of New York depends on the federal government. We have left this state hostage to the federal government, now controlled. He says he's not a Bolshevik, but he acts like one. Now controlled by a party that knows that the only way they could stay in business in Washington is to keep spending. Because that's how they've been buying votes. That's what the welfare process has been for years. You know that. And when you go back and someone tells you, wait, we had the surpluses under Clinton, they're lying. There were no surpluses. That was surpluses using government accounting, not real accounting. That was surpluses adding some of the highest surpluses we had in Social Security, which are going down now. Why? The baby boomers are retiring. So now you're going to have relatively more people retiring than working. And guess what we did? Forget about the budget process. We took the money out of the trust funds. There is no trust fund. There is no lockbox. That's a lie. They actually spent that money. So now we got the problem of finding that money that we took to put it back in the trust funds and also finding the money we need for this huge tsunami of baby boomers that are going to want their benefits. And that was Social Security 15 years ago. Now we got the big problem with Medicare, which is likely to go bankrupt much before Social Security. So let's not just talk about freedom and some amorphous principles. Let's talk about common sense accounting. And this is one of the reasons you got to send someone like me back to Congress. Because they don't understand it. I'm the author of the Chief Financial Officer and Financial Management Reform Act of 1990. Imagine a junior member of the minority party. Reagan was president, but the Congress was controlled by both
both houses by the Democratic Party. And I was so persistent, I got a bill passed that President Bush signed in 1990. You'll see his personal letter to me, "Dear Joe." You might say, "Well, how did he know you, Joe?" Because he came in three times with Barbara, because Barbara was born in my district, to campaign for me when he was vice president, when they couldn't believe I had taken the race and put it within 2 or 3 percentage points of winning. They sent in President Ford, Jack Kemp, Bob Dole three times, the vice president, but you'll see his beautiful letter to me in the back here saying, "Too bad you're not here, I'm signing your bill." Well, Chuck Bowser, the Comptroller General, several years after that said that that bill had already saved us billions of dollars. Now, they dumbed it down. They didn't put it in exactly the way I wanted it, because I wanted the chief financial officer to be a cabinet position. They put it three tiers down in the Treasury Department. That's like putting the fox in the chicken coop. That's what they did. And I wrote an article that appeared in the Washington Times in 1990, just after that, "Who's Minding the Store?" We have big problems. We have to wake up America. We have to somehow stop this spending. We're spending money we don't have. We're borrowing from countries that don't share our values. And this country will never be globally competitive, create jobs, and be safe on the road we are now. Now, one of the things I did on the cover of this book, and if you don't have it, please get it on the way out. You see what I'm carrying here? I'm carrying a congressman's voting card. It's plastic. I have it. It doesn't work anymore, but I got it in my pocket. It's a computer, okay? That card, it dawned on me when I was putting in, is a credit card. In fact, the first chapter of this book is the most expensive credit card in the world is a congressman or congresswoman's voting card. And I put it on the front. Credit line, unlimited. Expiration date, never. Bill to future generations. Here it is. That was 17 years ago. You can imagine the size today. Now, I just gave you the good news. You want the bad? The bad news is that if you took what's really being spent and is off the books, the $12 trillion today, you'd have to add $45 trillion for the liability for Social Security and Medicare that we know we have to pay. But it's not even on the statements that the federal government puts out. I went to testify this year, in February, before the Federal Accounting Standards Advisory Board, and I blew them away. In fact, I answered their questions. I made sure I answered all their questions in writing, but that was just a ploy to get me in. And then I just threw it out, and I just stood up and let them have it. And I said, "You are a conflicted group. When I passed this bill to create you, because we needed to get generally accepted accounting principles that was specifically geared to the public sector, so we separated it from the SEC-type generally accepted accounting principles, I didn't know that they were going to create the FASAB funded by the Treasury Department, the Congressional Budget Office, the GAO, and there's one other government group. So in effect, we did what we did with the rating companies. The people that we're supposed to guard are paying them. There's a conflict of interest. And I told them to their face, you're in conflict. Who comes on before me? David Walker, one of my former partners from Arthur Anderson. Pretty good guy. And he gives his testimony. We were talking about what should be on the books, what should be off the books. I went to my garage and I got the little booklet that was prepared by my firm when we prepared the first prototype statement, the U.S. Consolidated Financial Statements of the United States of America. Because I remember when we did that as a gift to the government, we did it for 5 years, we did it after we were hired by the Treasury to unbundle the books of New York City. Don't forget the bailout. We had that bailout. I was one of the partners on that team. That's how I learned so much about government accounting. And that's what I brought into Congress when I was elected. So that experience told me that something's wrong with the statement today. And today the statement is 118 pages. Can you imagine giving a member of the public a balance sheet, an income statement that's 118 pages long? That's what's being done today. Well, I had to testify, so I had to read it. I went with my wife Shirley one day early so I could read that whole thing, because these were 24 experts and I didn't want to get caught off guard. So I had to learn exactly where everything was. But the little booklet that Arthur Anderson put out had a little footnote saying the liability for Social Security in 1975 was $5 trillion. It's now much more than that.
And they said, this is a liability, and we put it on the balance sheet. 5 years later, when we gave it to the Treasury Department as our gift to continue doing, the first thing they did is took the liability off the books and put it as a footnote. And I went before this board. I said, how could, but David Walker said, well, you know something? The law says, Social Security, that if we run out, and Medicare too, if the trust fund runs out, there's no legal obligation for the United States of America to pay. Can you imagine? People have voted for senators and congressmen when they said it's a lockbox, remember Gore, right? And it's a trust fund, but now here's the Comptroller General of the United States saying we don't have to put it on the books because we don't have to pay it if we run out. I said, tell that to the people. They voted for people on it. And then I said to him, you know, you've got this foundation, the Pete Peterson Foundation, you just took out a two-page ad in the New York Times, and you said that the liability is $45 trillion for those. How could you tell the people that that's what our liability is, but you don't want to put it on the books? I get a call last week. He just did a book, Come Back America. One of the people that was there said, Joe, you won. In this book, he's changed his mind. He's now putting on the statements that amount. Listen, we have to be truthful with the people. The people are not getting the truth. The truth is very important. You know, there's a definition of truth. I don't know whether Thomas Paine said it. That all it wants, the truth, and all it seeks is the liberty of appearing. That's all. It just wants to appear. And sooner or later, it does appear. It's like what Lincoln said. You can't fool some of the people some of the time, or all the people some of the time. You can fool some of the people some of the time. Maybe all the people all of the, some of the time, but you can't fool all the people all the time because the truth does appear. Now, I see the hook is coming here. So what I have to tell you is there's a lot more to say, but I can't say it today. But remember what Ronald Reagan said in 1980. He says, the closest thing to eternal life in Washington is a government program. Once you start it, you can never get rid of it. And you can say the same about taxes. And be careful. No tax increases. And make sure the Bush tax cuts do not get eliminated, because that's going to be a tax increase. And be careful. You're in New York State. Don't listen to this revenge tax, $50 billion on the banks. That's our industry. We throw out the blue-collar jobs. Mike knows the port of New York is almost entirely in Newark. We're keeping part of it. He worked with me on this. We started a port rail task force in 1996. But don't get duped. New York's future is now, unfortunately for us, with those fire industries, brokerage firms, insurance, premium for insurance, all those financial firms. And we can't do anything to endanger them, because then you'll see a hole in our budget that no one's going to be able to fix. Well, God bless you. Nice to be here.
Leadership requires information. And by the way, we're in the information age. But information is not just words. The most important information we need today, especially in Washington and in Albany, are numbers. What are numbers? This is a reflection of the economic activity, the fiscal activity in Washington, the budgeting, then how we spend money, and then what is reported to the people. This is all very important. And leaders cannot function without having good numbers. Corporations today cannot function without having even independently certified numbers. And we don't even go that far in the federal government. And that's one of the reforms that I'd like to see. So to have leadership and to have reforms that count, we need access to what we're doing in an economic way. And that means numbers that are telling us what we're really spending, what we're really borrowing, not using an accounting system that keeps economic activity off the books. Because today we are using, for the budget process, something called a cash basis, a very rudimentary accounting system that you would use to balance your checkbooks. But we are the most sophisticated fiscal entity in the world, the United States of America. We need to use the best kind of accounting system, the one that is used by companies that sell stock and are then monitored by the Securities and Exchange Commission. Why? To protect shareholders. Well, you know, the government has to be sure that they're doing the same to protect the taxpayers.
and they're not doing that. So we need to see what it is that we're not doing so that we get an accurate reflection of what the economy is today, and that will point to the potential of this great country. Now, one of the things that I've talked about as a president of Truth in Government are specific reforms. One, the budget process. That has to be reformed. We need a fair, accurate budgeting, accounting, and reporting system. We don't have it right now. We do a lot of budgeting, but that budgeting is on the cash basis, and that's not the way you're going to control spending, because if you commit something and you have to spend it later, they're not going to then go back and say, well, let's adjust what we said for the budget, and it kind of gets lost in the shuffle. This is what's creating so much more being added to the national debt, and yet it's not reflected in the annual deficits. Number two, we need to take the chief financial officer position that I created in the CFO Act and put it in a cabinet position. Right now, it is part of the Treasury Department. In fact, it's three tiers down. And this, I said, is like putting the fox in the chicken coop. We need to be accurate and we need to be independent when it comes to numbers, and only a CFO that is in a separate position from the Treasury Department is going to be able to do that. As a matter of fact, I think we have to take financial management activity away from the Treasury Department and put it totally under the CFO in a separate entity. Why is that? The Treasury has enough to do. They have to worry about cash flow. We know that when we borrow, we have to sell Treasury bonds. So the Treasury has all kinds of functions, and including the budget function. We can't take that away from Congress. They should be involved. But when it comes to the highest levels of strategic planning and financial management, we need highly trained, professional, certified public accountants, and maybe some others, in a separate silo to be sure this country is not being compromised. Going further, I would tell you that we need to make sure that we take the whole issue of budgeting, accounting, reporting, and take it away from politicians. This is not going to be easy to do, because politicians love to control the numbers, because then when they get into their elections, they can pick and choose which numbers serve them best, but that's not the way you serve the people. So I would hope that we could be creative and come up with a new function, like the Fed, independent of the rest of government, so that when we promulgate accounting principles and budgeting principles and the kind of reports we need, that there would be no conflict whatsoever and we would come up with the fairest system possible. I think that is very important. Also, we need to report in a clear and accurate way to the people of the United States of America. To me, it's shocking when I look at the annual financial statement today, and I was part of the process that resulted in us getting financial statements today. They weren't issuing them back in the 70s and 80s. But today, the statement that I read at the end of the last fiscal year is 118 pages long. This is supposed to be the balance sheet and the profit and loss statement, the results of operations for the United States of America. Nobody's going to read that, except maybe a professional like me before I testify as I did before the Financial Accounting Standards Advisory Board last February. What we need is a one or two pager to summarize what we did as a country economically. And it should be clear, it should be dispersed to everybody, and today we have the technology to do that.